Hi, this is Brad, and we're going to talk about three more composers in this video, and then we'll stop for now. These are kind of like, you know, what happened after the big three of Terry Riley, Philip Glass, and Steve Reich. You know, there are some composers that also engaged in this kind of minimal approach to music, some following directly from the Steve Reich and Philip Glass in particular, and some kind of forging their own way. We're going to talk first about a composer who did kind of follow in the model of them, John Adams, born in 1947. And he heard some of Philip Glass and Steve Reich's orchestral music. Steve Reich also started moving into writing for standard orchestras, and not just his ensemble, as he grew more accepted. And John Adams was a composer very enamored of this, you know, and really enjoyed basically the fact that they kind of reinvigorated tonality, and they could do things with the tonal system that, you know, everybody said, well, after Wagner, it's, you know, the Tristan chord and all that. You know, they said, well, here's a new way of thinking about it. Here's a new way of presenting music. And, you know, that's kind of glorious. He was born in Worcester, Massachusetts. His dad was a clarinetist, so he was steeped in music. Went to Harvard, majored in music, and then went to study at the San Francisco Conservatory, where he then kind of worked his way up and became a mainstay, and still today is a musical advisor for the San Francisco Symphony Orchestra. And also got a pretty good gig doing a lot of work for PBS and other places, and kind of made his way as an independent composer. Didn't really have a lot in the way of, you know, academic sort of background. Because again, back then, there was this weird uptown, downtown divide. Minimalism was still not accepted in academia. However, that changed. Adams went on to win the Pulitzer Prize for some of his music, and now he's definitely, you know, part of the, quote, establishment. I'll just play you a real quick excerpt from some of his music. This is a piece called Shaker Loops for String Orchestra, and it gives you a sense of, you know, he's absorbing the rhythmic vitality of Philip Glass, you know, combining it with some of the interesting kind of phasing techniques of Steve Reich, and coming up with a pretty amazing piece of music. Yeah. So you can hear it has that kind of, like I said, the rhythmic vitality. This is a little later on, you know. But again, it has that kind of, you know, long extended form of tonality that's kind of becoming the hallmark of minimalist composition. Adams went on and wrote some very well-known operas, one commemorating Nixon's visit to China called Nixon in China, and another one he gained a bit of notoriety, you know, good and bad, for, called The Death of Klinghoffer. It was very political. We can talk about that in class, I suppose. But I don't want to, you know, I'm going to kind of move ahead and talk about another sort of composer that's been called a minimalist, but came to it from a very different direction. He was not kind of looking at Philip Glass or Steve Reich. He came to it from his kind of cultural background. It's a composer named Arvo Pärt. And I don't have the diacriticals, but there's supposed to be an umlaut over the A there. Okay, Arvo Pärt, he was born in 1935 in Tallinn, Estonia. And he had a strong career going as, a serial composer, studying in various places, teaching at Vienna, Berlin Hochschule, the Tallinn Conservatory. He came to it from a very spiritual sort of background. He ultimately kind of rediscovered his roots in his Russian Orthodox Church heritage, which had been suppressed during the communist control of Estonia. And after Estonia gained its freedom, primarily through music, the music was a big part of their cultural identity, Pärt began to compose very austere pieces that had this deep kind of spiritual sort of dimension to them. And I'm going to play you a piece of his called Pokajanin. It's an excerpt. And this is the kind of music where if I wanted to be a nasty music hum professor, I could put this on a test and say, what period is this from? Because it has elements of both high modernism and even early chant. But I'm going to play a bit of it and you can get a sense of that. And a little later on in the piece, you'll move to segments more like this. Which is, it's intensely spiritual music. And he meant it that way because this is part of how he defined himself. Just gorgeous, gorgeous work. And again, people say it's minimalist, it had that tonality. It very much dwelt upon almost a meditative approach to music. Okay, and the final composer that I want to talk about in kind of these kind of late minimalists is a composer named Brian Eno. And he was born in 1948 in Suffolk, England. His father was a postman, Eno. Some of you may have heard of him. He's also quite well known as a popular musician and producer. Produced a lot of U2's music and has been involved in a lot of kind of high end sort of pop music stuff. He went to art school. Did not go to composer school or anything like that. And basically played in a band that was pretty well known back in the late 60s, early 70s, called Roxy Music. Kind of an art school sort of band. Went on to, continue to do his own solo work after the band split up, but had a remarkable life experience where at one point he'd kind of overextended himself and suffered from this collapsed lung. And he was in a hospital And a friend of his brought a record of, I think, Renaissance harp music and put it on, but didn't turn it up loud enough. And Eno was laying there in the hospital bed. He recounts his story and said that, you know, he could just barely hear fragments of the music. And he thought, what a wonderful thing. Music that's kind of there, and he termed it as listenable as it was ignorable. And he came up with a whole new, or to him it was new, and to a lot of people, that he called ambient music. You know, this is kind of the progenitor of chill out music at, you know, various rave rooms and things like that. And basically, you know, came up with algorithmic approaches to do these things. But a lot of his music is intended to be, in a sense, background music. Here's an example of one of his early works of this called Discrete Music. I'm going to run it ahead a little bit because it takes a while to get going. Here we go. Again, this is music that does not change a whole lot over time. Here we are, 20 minutes away from where we were. Yeah, the idea is that this is music almost like sculpture. It just kind of exists in a place. And, you know, this is very deliberate on Eno's part. And in fact, he released a CD not too long after that called Music for Airports. As listenable as it is ignorable. Eno built a whole career out of this. You know, again, it has all the hallmarks we've been talking about with minimalism, you know, very tonal kind of based, you know, very meditative in a way, you know. In fact, the idea was actually to promote calm with this. The Music for Airports was actually performed at JFK Airport for several months, I think maybe a year, back in the late 1970s, early 1980s. So, it's a, I get a real kick out of this. Eno built a whole career out of this, and it's fun stuff.